So people often ask, you know, what does New York University look like? And unlike many speakers who probably get here and they show you beautiful pictures of their campus and all these wonderful things, I can't do that because NYU doesn't actually have a campus. It's a very, very urban university that just kind of sits in the middle of Greenwich Village, which is one of the neighborhoods in New York. And the only way that you can tell that a building that you might encounter as you walk around that part of New York is an NYU building is by this symbol here, all right? That's the torch symbol. And so I can show you, this is, for example, the building where my department is housed. It's called the Silver Center. And you can see it just sits on a busy street. And there is the characteristic NYU torch flag. That's how you know that that building is an NYU building. Otherwise, there's nothing characteristic about this building, per se, compared to any other building in the neighborhood. The only thing that we have going for us is that the building kind of surrounds a very pretty park called Washington Square Park. And so you can see some pictures of it from this winter. All right, this is after a fairly recent snowstorm that we had a couple weeks ago. And you can't see it too well, but over there is the Silver Center where our building is located. There's another picture of the park, and this building here also happens to be an NYU building. So that's essentially our campus, is this pretty park that sits in the middle of all these NYU buildings. Okay, so what I'm gonna do in this, we have two parts today, I guess. We have a first lecture for about 90 minutes, we get a break, and then another one. In the first one, what I wanna do is to sort of motivate what it is in molecular simulation that drives us to try to bridge the time scale problem. You know, what are the kinds of problems that we're interested in? And we're going to talk about sort of basic integrator technology. All right, so how do we actually go about deriving, and I have a set of equations of motion, how can I go about deriving an integrator for them? And then we'll get into sort of some of the basics of multiple time stepping. And we'll see what kinds of gains in terms of efficiency that you can get from that. The second part will be more advanced things. We'll get into some statistical mechanics, how to use these techniques for calculating free energies and enhanced sampling methods. And then I'll kind of finish off by showing you how we get to extremely long time steps in molecular simulations. Okay, so the paper I'm mostly going to be sort of basing this on, although certainly not the only one, but the one that really got us our start in this area, it goes all the way back to 1992, all right? So don't do the calculation in your head because then you'll get an idea of how old I am, and that's supposed to be secret information. So, but it's this paper we published back in 1992. I was a graduate student in those days, and it's a paper on reversible multiple time step molecular dynamics, and you can see that it's kind of done okay in terms of citations. It now has about 1,500 if you look at the ISI. And basically here, you can see it's got a sort of recent surge because there are new areas coming up that this can apply to, not only in what we're working on, but in first principles molecular dynamics, also in coarse-grained molecular dynamics. So it's kind of seeing a little bit of a spike in terms of its usage. Okay, so as I said, the first thing I wanted to kind of talk about is why we need to bridge time scales in molecular simulation, and what is it that makes this such a difficult problem? Okay, so here you're looking at a little simulation of a coarse-grained model of a protein, all right? It's not a big one. It's a protein that is supposed to undergo a folding transition. In this case, it folds up into a little beta barrel, and all the beads here represent individual amino acids. So the red ones are supposed to be hydrophobic, these green ones are supposed to be hydrophilic, and then around the blue ones, they're neutral. You have hairpin turns there, like as if they were proline. And then here you're looking at a simulation of a molecular crystal. In this case, it's a simple one, it's benzene, and it's undergoing a series of solid-solid, in other words, polymorphic phase transitions, all right? And these both come from computer simulations that we did. You would say, okay, so these are two examples of problems where you have a very, very small time step that you kind of need if you want to resolve, if you're doing atomistic calculation, and you want to resolve the bond vibrations, let's say CH or OH bond vibrations. These things occur, of course, on the order of about femtoseconds, so a typical time step that I would need for a simulation like this would be about one, maybe a half a femtosecond, right? But at the end of the day, what I want to reach is time scales long enough to see processes like this, or processes like this. And these are very, very, very long time scale processes. So I need to bridge orders of magnitude in terms of time scales. Multiple time stepping is not going to get you there all by itself, but it's something that you can use to, on top of whatever it is you want to employ, to bridge these time scales to give you an extra boost. Okay. Now, what is it that these two things have in common? These are very sort of chemically, physically different kinds of systems. But it was pointed out in a very nice paper about 10 years ago by Jack Dunnett and Harold Chiraga that what underlies a problem like this or a problem like this is what's called the rough energy landscape problem. And this is where all these time scales are sort of buried. Right? So what this looks like, this is a cartoon of what a typical potential energy surface looks like that describes these systems. This is only in two dimensions, and of course, a real surface is in 3n dimensions. But at the end of the day, what this is trying to illustrate is that we have a lot of sort of local basins that characterize local states of the system. And then I have relatively high barriers that exist between these basins. Relatively high meaning they're high on the order of kT, which is where you're doing your simulation. Therefore, the probability of crossing such a barrier in your calculation is fairly low. That means you spend a lot of time in one particular basin, sort of moving around there before you actually experience a transition to the next one. And it's this underlying roughness of the potential energy landscape that leads to the multiple time scale problem. All right, and so it's still, I'd say, an outstanding grand challenge to try to find techniques that can actually bridge time scales like what you're seeing here in these little movies. Okay, so for example, if you were looking at biomolecules or even many kinds of polymers, the sorts of time scales that you have look like this. If you're, as I said, if you're doing a fully atomistic model, then typically to get local bond vibrations, you need be able to resolve time scales that are on the order of femto to picoseconds. All right? And that will sort of give you, in this case, bond vibrations, bends, torsions, short and long range interactions, and kind of motions of side chains in your protein. Then nanosecond to microsecond kind of gets you into secondary structure motion. All right? Loop motions. Resolution of secondary structure, what we call sort of medium scale motions, right? And there are some fast folding proteins that might actually show evidence of folding kind of here at the outer end of this. But real subdomain motions or real folding events, at least locally, occur more on the microsecond to the millisecond time scale, right? And then if you want to get sort of full folding of larger proteins, you're going to be kind of in the millisecond up to hours. And then if you were interested, let's say, in, for example, exploring amyloid formation, aggregation of proteins, that's a process that if you think about like Alzheimer's disease, that obviously occurs over years. All right? So we're talking about something like 23 orders of magnitude that need to be bridged here. And as of yet, that's still an unsolved problem. All right? So the techniques I'm going to be talking about today get you sort of partway a little step there, but not all the way, all right? And that's still a huge problem, is how do we bridge from here to here? Coarse graining can help, but it doesn't get you all the way. So this is still outstanding. Well, let me show you a little movie of such an event. Okay, this is a little 9-residue peptide in water, as you see. And what we're simulating here is a folding event, all right? This is a fairly standard simulation. The only thing that we did was we kind of scaled some of the masses in order to help accelerate the motion. And you can see that on this time scale of this simulation, we're actually able to capture one event. Okay, that's kind of nice. You get one folding event. But at the end of the day, you don't have statistics on that event. All right? So I can form this little hairpin structure that is very close to the native structure of this thing. But at the end of the day, I don't really have anything that I can compute from this because it's one event. All right? In order to get statistics, I need many, many, many such folding events. And to get this one event in sort of a typical computer that I have, we needed to run nanoseconds in order to get that to happen. And that's a fairly small example of a folding event. All right? So it's a relatively short relatively short amino acid sequence. All right, let me show you another one. This is a little alanine decamer. This is using an enhanced sampling technique that we've been developing, and I'll talk a little bit about that in the second half. But here's one where I can actually simulate the kinds of things that give me statistics, all right? Folding and unfolding many times. Now, what this thing likes to fold into, in contrast to the last one, is this folds into a helix, all right, as you can see happening here. And fortunately, with the technique that we've been applying, we can actually get this thing to unfold and fold into the helix many times. And on the way, it visits some structures that are sort of hairpin-like. Oops, all right, keep it going. All right, and again, we can see I return to the helix state. I have a fairly high propensity for being in that state. But every now and then, it's going to, hopefully that'll do, it'll do that soon, it will unfold and pass through a series of other structures like that. All right, so random coil, partially hairpin structures. And then finally, let's see if it gets back to the helix again. OK, we have a long period where it's not actually doing it. But I think it actually does. There, like that. All right. So we have enough events in this simulation to actually start to look at some real observables of that. And this is actually not a very challenging system to do. This is just a little alanine chain. OK. The other area that we're focusing on, which I sort of hinted at in that second slide, is in the area of crystal structure prediction. Now, we're approaching it from the point of view of material science. Right? And usually you don't think of pharmaceuticals as having anything to do with material science, but in fact, it actually does. Right? And there was an issue of the Materials Research Bulletin from 2006 that featured pharmaceutical crystals as a frontier area in materials research. And the reason is that it's all about crystal engineering and discovery of crystal structures and polymorphs. All right, so that's one of the things that we want to know. And you know, getting polymorphic transitions is another multiple time scale or multiple time step and type of process. This is a huge area, by the way. It's about a $500 billion global market, probably even gone up a little bit since I made this slide. How about half of that is still in the US, and the majority of it is in the area of small molecule pharmaceuticals and small molecule crystals. Okay. And I would say this thing that was pointed out by John Maddox in 1998 is still true. It's a continuing scandal in physical sciences that it remains impossible to predict the structure of even the simplest crystalline solids from their chemical composition. And in fact, the Cambridge Structure Database runs a competition every, I think, 4 years or so to spur the development of computational techniques for structure prediction. And what they do is they provide about 6 or 7 molecules, and they just give you the chemical composition and the molecular structure. And from that, you're supposed to compute what the crystal structures are. All right? And of course, the group that gets it closest to the already experimentally known structure, which they don't reveal when they announce the competition, they actually win. OK, so let me give you an example of this. So what we mean by polymorphism, by the way, is the ability of a compound to form multiple crystal structures. And there's a famous case of ritonavir, which is an HIV protease inhibitor. Okay, this was a multi-million dollar investment on both the company that made it, Abbott Labs, and the National Institutes of Health. And it looks like this. All right. That's a very difficult molecule to compute crystal structures for because it has so much internal flexibility. Right? What was known at the time that they put it on the market in 1996 is that they had this crystal structure. That's all they knew. All right? And it turns out that this is bioavailable, and it works as an HIV protease inhibitor, as you see here. Unfortunately, there was another structure that Abbott Labs didn't know about. All right? Now these structures are called form 1 and form 2, and it turns out that this polymorphic transition occurred spontaneously on the shelf. So as the drug was being stored in warehouses, it was transforming from this to this. All right, and that structure actually is a very low free energy, very stable structure that therefore is not bioavailability. It wasn't soluble. All right, so what they had to do was they had to recall the drug in 1998, which gives you a lot of bad PR, and of course it's very expensive to do this. And they had to reformulate it, take them 4 years to do that in a way that this transition didn't happen. This is the kind of thing you'd like to know about before you go to market with your drug, by the way. So, you know, this is an area where the experiments, the crystallization experiments are time consuming, they're expensive, they're difficult to do. So computation could play a major role here if good algorithms could be made available for doing this kind of problem. Okay, so now let's get into some of the details about how we do the calculation. So what I'm showing you here is a typical force field. All right, for atomistic simulations. And you can see it contains bond stretching terms, as we see here. So these are usually simple harmonic oscillators. We have angle stretching terms. All right, these are all often also represented as harmonic oscillators. It's because of electron pair repulsion. The angle can't really change by all that much. We have dihedral angle motion, as you see here. All right. And that's usually some sort of cosine series to represent multiple minima and multiple barriers. On top of that, we have dispersion forces, often represented as a Leonard Jones or maybe a Williams type potential. And then we have Coulomb interactions. And buried in all of this is a whole lot of time scales. All right? Now, as I hinted at in the very first slide, if we want to resolve this kind of motion, all right, we need time steps typically that are on the order of femtoseconds, or maybe even one femtosecond, and yet we're trying to bridge all the way out to something like microseconds or milliseconds, depending on what it is we're looking at. So that's a lot of orders of magnitude that we have to bridge. Okay, now one of the things that we can do is we can sort of coarse-grain away some of this motion that we're not interested, bond vibrations, bending terms, and what we can do is we can replace individual atoms by beads. And that's at the heart of a method called dissipative particle dynamics. I'll get to the details of that later. But this is a technique that's been used fairly successfully, I would say, to predict the morphologies of proton exchange membranes and alkaline exchange membranes for fuel cell applications. So here's a typical polymer of the type that's used in proton exchange membranes. All right, it's a perfluorosulfonic acid type membrane. I think this is very close to the membrane called Nafion. And in principle, what you would do is you can replace large groups of these individual CF2 and SO3 type groups by just simple beads. All right? And then you run them in a kind of coarse-grained simulation, and what you can get is an overall morphology at different levels of hydration. And you can see how the change in this thing goes as you increase the amount of water in it. Well, these kinds of simulations, in principle, represent tens of millions of atoms. The coarse graining brings it down to a level where maybe it's several hundred thousand atoms. So it's actually a lot easier to simulate really big systems with this kind of approach. Right? And one of the things that we want to branch into with this sort of methodology is a new area called alkaline exchange membranes. And here are morphology predictions. Have yet to be done. The kinds of functional groups that would replace these sulfonic acid groups on an alkaline membrane might be something like this with a alkyl ammonium or something with a phosphonium, all right? And we need to do morphology studies. So we're looking also at trying to do coarse-grained simulations that will get us there. Now, the kinds of models that are often used for this sort of coarse-graining are very, very simple. All right, for example, we might have intermolecular forces that are kind of simple power laws, all right? And they're short range, so they actually go to zero at distances larger than a certain cutoff. And then we might have bonds, all right, that we can represent, again, by simple harmonic oscillators. So these models are extremely simple. There's still multiple time scale in nature. And then we use them in conjunction with fairly complicated equations of motion that we'll look at a little bit later in order to help us simulate the overall structural features of these things. Okay, good. So we're going to start getting into some of the details. And I'm going to start with just simple classical mechanics. All right, now let's think back. Classical mechanics, of course, tells us that an object in motion remains in motion until some sort of force acts on it. So for example, like this. Right? This is a really good example of classical mechanics. All right, but it's not one that we typically have to worry about in chemistry, right? Unless you're simulating penguins. So we might look at something like this. Right, there we go. Okay, this is something I show my freshmen when I teach freshman chemistry. It's a simple ideal gas simulation. And the only forces that we have here are the forces that the walls of the box exert on the particles. So if you watch these things, you see the atoms moving in straight line trajectories until they hit a wall, and then there's a force on them that changes the direction of the motion. Very simple example of forces changing the motion of particles. If you add in interactions, okay, then you can simulate something like this. This is water. Okay, very simple simulation. This is actually a very detailed model from first principles molecular dynamics. So everything is being computed from the electronic structure on the fly. And what you can see here is kind of, water moving around. The most important thing is to look at the breaking of, probably can't use my pointer, I think that's what's causing this to happen. But you can look at these dashed lines. These represent hydrogen bonds, and you can see that they kind of form and then break again. Sometimes molecules, water molecules will change their hydrogen bonding partners. And all of this is tied up then with the diffusion process of water, which of course this simulation is very short, so you're not going to see that. But with interactions, you get more complicated systems. All right, and then, for example, if I want to simulate a crystal, this is an example of a, whoa, wait, where'd it go? Oh, I don't know why this movie isn't working. But anyway, so I can bring it up in a different talk and we can have a look at it. Bear with me 2 seconds here. Okay, yeah, this is the movie I wanted to show. And you can see this thing undergoing a series of very, very clear polymorphic transitions between different structures in this naphthalene crystal. All right, and this is the kind of thing that we'd like to be able to predict from more or less first principles. All right, so that gives us structure prediction. Okay, so you can see the transition back again, and it does it a number of times in that simulation. Okay, so we looked at all that. All right, so let me now flip on the lights. Okay, let's just remind ourselves some of the details. So I'm going to mute the display. Let's see, did that mute? Right, there we go. Okay. Okay, so I'm going to start off with just simple Newtonian mechanics. Right, we'll get into some more complicated paradigms a little bit later. So my paradigm is this. We have atomic coordinates that I represent as vectors for n particles in my system. And I imagine that all my particles live in some box. This is the typical statistical mechanics picture. All right, so everything is inside of a box of some kind. Volume equals V. And so all my particles in here have a particular position denoted by a 3 vector. And then, of course, we have their velocities as well. All right, and if I know the positions and the velocities of everything in the system, then I have a complete picture of the classical state. Right? That's all I need. So I need to know where a particle is, and I need to know where it's going. Right? From the point of view of classical mechanics, that's all you need to know. Right? And so what tells me what this motion is of course, Newton's second law, which tells me that the forces that the particles experience, which are themselves functions of all the coordinates, that's equal to the mass the particle has, and most importantly, times its acceleration. Right? Notice I'm using this over dot notation for a derivative. I hope everyone's familiar with that. So what this represents is a set of 3n coupled second order differential equations. And of course, we can't solve them, so we go to big computers to do that job for us. All right, I'm going to start off by considering only conservative forces. And these are forces that I can derive from this thing that I've introduced already called the interparticle potential. All right, and if the forces are given by the derivative of this scalar function, then on top of the equations of motion that tell us where everything is going, so allow us to predict at any time t the positions and the velocities, we have a conserved energy. And the energy is, of course, the sum of kinetic and potential energies. And so in order to show that that energy is conserved, all I have to do is to take dE dt. And so from the chain rule, I see that that's just from the kinetic energy and from the potential energy, I have a du dr dot ri dot. Okay, so m times r double dot over here, that's just equal to the force dot r dot. And du dr, since I've defined things to be conservative, that's minus the force dot ri dot. And so obviously that's equal to 0, which is why we want the forces to be defined that way, so that I have this conserved energy. Okay. Eraser.
Oh,
I think I need this thing on the sponge over there. That's what I need. Thanks. Okay. Well, actually, let me put that up there and go to the second board. Okay, so as I said, there's no way that we can solve these equations directly. So we need numerical techniques. Whoa. Okay. Okay, the numerical solution for these things basically amounts to we discretize time. Into steps, all right, that have a length delta t. That defines my time discretization. And so we have discrete times tk, which are some integer times the time step, k delta t, all right? And so k ranges here from, let's say, 0 up to the total number of steps that I want. M defines the length of the simulation. So M typically is on the order of hundreds of thousands, millions, tens of millions. It's a very large number. And then T is obviously the total time is M times the number of steps that I want to do. OK, and the numerical problem is this. Given positions and velocities at tk. In other words, given r1 at tk to rn at tk and velocities, we want to predict the next one. So tk plus delta t. And of course, the same thing for the velocities, r1 dot to rn dot at tk plus delta t. That's the numerical problem. Because you can then, once you have an algorithm for doing that, you just iterate it over and over and over again. And I generate the full trajectory. So we want to be able to go from something at time tk to the next step, tk plus delta t. Well, the most obvious and kind of naive way of doing this is we just use a Taylor series. Okay, so let's just review how we do that from a Taylor series point of view. So let's look at, say, the ith position at tk plus delta t. What I would do is I would simply expand that in a Taylor series around delta t is equal to 0. All right, so the first term would be ri at that position, delta t times its derivative, and then delta t squared over 2 times second derivative. And you could go further out in that series if you wanted, but we'll see that there is kind of a reason to stop here and that everything that we see in this expansion is readily available. The positions and velocities we already have by construction, and the second derivative is just the force. So that I have from my model. In other words, it's just force over the mass. And I should write this really as R at tk. So when I write R like this, I really mean the full set of positions. It's my little shorthand for denoting all the positions in my system. And so the forces have to be evaluated at those positions, which I have at time t, that I have. If I try to go to the next term, which would be a delta t cubed, I would have to get a time derivative of the force. And that I really don't want to do. That's an expensive thing to compute. All right, so we kind of stop there. And if I stop there, then the error that I make is obviously on the order of delta t cubed. Right? So that looks like a perfectly good way to get positions. And in fact, it is. That's a very typical integration step for positions. But now I say, well, let me try to apply that to velocities. So I do the same kind of expansion. And suddenly, to get to the next order, I would need a forced time derivative, which I really don't want to do. I would need r triple dot. So that's the time derivative of a force. So I look at this and I say, I'm not going to get very far by using just a simple Taylor series expansion of the velocities. I need to do something a little bit more intelligent than that in order to get ri dot at tk plus delta t. The way you can do that, actually, is to take your position expansion, but actually apply it backwards. Okay? So instead of trying to do this, what we would do is I would say, oh, I have a good expansion, and I can use it to predict the positions at tk from the positions at tk plus delta t simply by stepping backwards in time. I reverse the sign of the time step. So in other words, I'd have a minus delta t ri dot tk, and then a delta t squared over 2m and the forces, which would need to be evaluated at tk plus delta t. And if I do that, I'm still good to order delta t cubed without needing a force derivative. But what you see here, whoops, this is tk plus delta t. Now I have a way to get the velocities at the time that I want them that's still good to order delta t cubed. So all I have to do here is to solve for these velocities at tk. And that looks like 1 over delta t So I have that little difference divided by the time step. And then plus delta t squared over 2m and the forces. And then if I take this expression for the positions and simply plug it in there, what I get is something that looks like ri dot at tk plus delta t plus a delta t over 2m and the force at the initial position plus the force at the time advanced position. All right, and that's a perfectly good way of advancing the system to the next time. That's a perfectly good algorithm. It's still order delta t cubed. And in fact, this is what's in most codes that do molecular dynamics. So these two boxed equations comprise something called velocity Verlet. All right, very well-known integrator. By the way, if you have any questions, you know, feel free to interrupt. Yes?
Why doesn't the order get divided clear.
Actually, yeah, it's a very good question, but there's a subtle point here, which is that if you actually could evaluate this next term, I actually can show this not with this Taylor series approach, but with an operator-based approach, that actually the algorithm is in fact good to order delta t to the fourth as well, all right? But only in positions. So it's true that when you divide by delta t, yes, you lose one order of the time step. But it's at order delta t to the fourth term, which then gets divided at the end of the day, then this thing does become a third order, or it has the first error term is delta t cubed. And so it's actually still good to delta t squared. Okay, let's. Now maybe. Let me go back to a couple of slide issues here. All right, so. I guess I have to unmute it. There we go. That works. Okay, so this method satisfies a couple of very important properties of classical mechanics. All right, and we're going to see again soon more explicitly how this comes about. But it preserves the time reversibility. All right, so the laws of classical mechanics are known to be time reversible. You can integrate them forward in time and backward in time. You get the same answer, and it preserves that. It's also what's called volume preserving. So this is very important for statistical mechanics. And what that means is that if I calculate the Jacobian, let's say I had one coordinate and one momentum or velocity. If I calculate this determinant, it's equal to 1. So I take the derivative of time-advanced positions and velocities with respect to their initial values, take the determinant of that, I get 1. That's volume preserving, all right? And it's also symplectic, which is related, that if I take this matrix here, which is sort of a metric on my space of positions and velocities, and I do this little matrix multiplication, I preserve that. All right, that's a symplectic method. And symplectic methods are known to have incredible stability, which makes them really, really good for numerical use. Right? And that's why they're favored over essentially any other approach that you can find in your typical numerical methods textbook. OK, now as I said, this is a method that is kind of in every molecular dynamics code. And if you just apply it straightforwardly, you get molecular dynamics. And if there is a group out there in New York City, actually it's the group of David Shaw. And what he does is he does very straightforward MD calculations, but he has an extremely fast computer. So he's the only one out there, but he's a guy who can kind of start to reach the hundreds of microseconds and even millisecond time scale with his simulations, all right? And so this is an example from a recent science paper of his, where he actually looked at the folding of a small protein. I think it was something like a 35-residue protein. So relatively small, it's a fast folder. And here is a trace of, this is in case, looking at the RMSD to the native state of the protein as a function of time out to 100 microseconds, all right? And what I want to kind of point out by looking at this shows the classic progress of a rare event, which folding is a rare event, all right? What a rare event means, as I said, with that rough energy landscape picture, is that you spend a lot of time in a local basin, and then only every now and then do you see a transition to a new state. And that's exactly what you're seeing here. So here you see lots of rattling around in one basin, maybe some large fluctuations. But at the end of the day, you have to get all the way out to 30 microseconds. And then, wow, I see a very rapid transition, which is characteristic of rare events. Right? You're crossing a high barrier. And so you don't spend a lot of time in that barrier region. And now suddenly, I'm in a new state. And I spend tens of microseconds there. I go down to the folded state again, back up, and then when I come back down, I'm in that native state for many, many microseconds before I see another transition. Typical rare event type of behavior. All right? And so in order to see just a few events, so here he claims to see about 10 events, all right, we have to run hundreds of microseconds in order to get it. Okay, and that's what makes this kind of simulation very, very, very challenging. Here you can actually see some focusing in on some local processes. So this is right around where the transition happens to the folded state. Here's an unfolding event, all right. It takes a long time to get this, yes?
So why don't we use adaptive time stepping?
Adaptive time stepping is not time reversible.
And this is bad. I don't know why is it bad.
Because it breaks one of the fundamental symmetries of classical mechanics. The laws of motion are time reversible. Adaptive time stepping methods, I mean, they're kind of neat, but they are not time reversible because they depend on how things are progressing forward. And you wouldn't get the same sequence of time steps running backward. You lose time reversibility.
Can you say why again this Verlet algorithm is so special?
So the three sort of basic things about classical mechanics that are important, it preserves. It is time reversible, so I can run it forward and backward and I get the same state. I run it forward one step and then backwards, I get back to where I started. All right. It's volume preserving. And so that means that, let's say, a cluster of points in my space of all possible positions and velocities, what I call phase space, and we'll come to that in a minute. If I integrate it, the volume of that cluster doesn't grow. All right. So this is important in statistical mechanics. And then this is the symplectic condition. So classical mechanics satisfies that, and the integrator does as well. Okay. Okay, let's actually write this out. This is probably worth doing a little bit more slowly. Okay, so in order to get a little bit more sophisticated than simple Taylor series and things like that, which is what we need to derive fancier methods, we need a different language than just F equals NA, right? And that comes in through what's called the Hamiltonian formulation of classical mechanics. And Hamiltonian uses, instead of velocities, it uses momenta. The momentum of a particle is just its mass times its velocity. Right? So if you re-express the energy in terms of momenta and positions, E looks like P squared over 2m plus U. And this is called the Hamiltonian. And in my shorthand notation, it's just a function of R and P. All right? And so the equations of motion are always given by something called Hamilton's equations. Which look like R dot is dh dp. And for that Hamiltonian, that looks like pi over m. And then p dot is minus th dr. That's, for this Hamiltonian, minus du dr, which is just the force. Right? These are completely equivalent to Newton's equations of motion. The nice thing about Hamilton's equations is that actually for any Hamiltonian, not just this type of Hamiltonian, but for any Hamiltonian, these are the equations of motion. They'll always give you the correct equations of motion. Okay, and like an energy, the Hamiltonian is preserved, is conserved. We can see that just by taking dh dt. And here, I don't even need the explicit form of the Hamilton equations of motion. If I just use the chain rule, I get dh d r dot plus dh dp p dot and then if I just use the fact that r dot is dh dp and p dot is minus, there's a dot there, minus dh dr, I get zero. OK, so the Hamiltonian is, in fact, explicitly conserved without even knowing that r dot's p over m and p dot is f, just by using this primitive form. So that always works. Right? You can see the Hamiltonian is conserved. And so this the fact that you have r dot is the hdp and p dot is minus the hdr, that is what's called the symplectic structure. And that's one of the things you want to preserve in classical mechanics. OK, so we can actually recast the equations of motion of classical mechanics in terms of an operator structure. Makes it look a little bit more like quantum mechanics. So I introduce an operator that I'm going to denote IL, all right? Where L, I is the square root of minus 1, really. And L is Hermitian. And it's defined as follows. IL is equal to the sum I equals 1 to n it's dh dp dot d by dr minus dhdr d by dp. All right, so it's a differential operator. And for those of you who know something about the bracket structure of quantum classical mechanics, it's just you take the Poisson bracket of whatever these derivatives act on with the Hamiltonian. Don't worry if you don't recognize that notation. It's not really important. So for the Hamiltonian that we considered above, what this becomes is p over m dot d by dr plus, in this case, the force dot dh dp. And so I claim that if you take this operator, you can use it to replace the equations of motion that I wrote down there with a set of operator equations that look like r dot is IL on r, and p dot is IL on p. OK, and it should be pretty obvious that the position derivative of momentum, for example, gives you 0. Position derivative of momentum gives you 1 for that particular value of I. And that gives you p dot as f. Same thing over here. The momentum derivative of r gives you 0. Position derivative gives you 1 for that particular value of I. And that gives you r dot is in p over m. So we have this nice little operator structure. OK, and in general, let's introduce a 6n dimensional vector that I'll just denote x. And x is the collection of all the positions and all the momenta. All right, this is called the phase space vector. it really is a vector that lives in a 6n dimensional space, 3n positions and 3n momenta. And in terms of this vector, I can write the equations of motion as simply x dot is ilx. All right? So that's Hamilton's equations or Newton's equations written in about four symbols. Okay. The reason for doing that is that we can actually solve those equations formally, analytically. It just looks like a little first-order differential equation. So the solution, the formal solution, is this. Given an initial set of positions and momenta, which we can denote in our shorthand as x0, then x of t is e to the ilt x of 0. All right? That is a formal solution to classical mechanics. Doesn't mean you can evaluate what that operator is, but that is a solution to every classical mechanical problem that you have. And so now the time reversibility of classical mechanics is really easy to show. All right? If I take e to the minus ilt on x of t, that should get me back to where I started from. And obviously, if I do that, these two things cancel out, and I just get back to x of 0. Right? So that's time reversibility. Volume preservation. We can see that as follows. If I take dx of t with respect to dx of 0, and I take the determinant of that, that's just the determinant of e to the ilt of that operator. Well, e to the I is actually unitary because L is Hermitian. What's the determinant of a unitary operator? It's 1. Every unitary operator has unit determinant, so this is equal to 1. So that's how you can very easily see volume preservation as well. Okay. Let's do it this way so you can still see. Okay, so now we want to make this into a useful tool for us. So I have this nice formal solution of classical mechanics, but I have no way of evaluating that operator. Right? And the reason is that this IL is really the sum of two terms. Okay, so IL1 is the sum P over M dot ddr. IL2 is the sum I equals 1 to n of f ddp, okay? And unfortunately, the commutator between these two operators is not 0. These operators don't commute. And as a result, when I write out what this thing is, as a sum, an exponential of the sum of two operators, I can't simply write this as a product of two operators. Okay, that's not true. So that makes it difficult to evaluate the action of the operator. That's why we need big computers to do all of our calculations, because IL1 and IL2 don't commute with each other. Okay. But there is a theorem that actually allows us to make progress on this. And it's called the Trotter theorem. And that's what allows us to derive integrators. OK, so what does that theorem say? It says that if I have the exponential of the sum of two operators, I can actually write that as the limit of some integer going to infinity e to the il2 t over 2m e to the il1 t over m e to the il2 t over 2m all raised to the nth power. Who's seen this before? Anyone seen this before? OK, that is an exact identity. I'm not going to prove it because the proof is very involved. It would take us about the whole day to do. All right, so you have to just accept it, that that is a proved theorem. OK, so what it kind of says is that if I can take the time and divide it by m, and then if I take this operator that I get and I act with it m times, I can get this back, provided I'm willing to let m go to infinity. In other words, if I have an infinite number of actions of this operator, then I can get my full time interval, and the result will be exact. All right. Unfortunately, I can't really do that in practice. But what I can do is, in the computer, say, well, all right, m, I can't let m be infinity, but let me let it be a really big number. So in the computer, we don't take the limit. We just say, as an approximation, you do this. Okay. Now, how do I get from here to a one-step integrator? I take the 1 over nth power of both sides. And if I identify t over m as my interval, which is what we did before, then this becomes e to the il delta t, which is, of course, exactly e to the il1 il2 delta t. And it becomes this kind of symmetric breakdown. And the error that I make, I can prove, is order delta t cubed. How do I do that? Well, the way you would do that is you would Taylor expand this side, and you would Taylor expand this side. And you work through all the commutators when you do that. And what you get, you'll find, is that, again, the first order term, actually, this is really order delta t to the fourth. All right, but remembering what we did before, the velocity step gives us an order less than that. So really, I should write this as delta t cubed. And that is the leading order that is non-vanishing in this case. So this is an order delta t cubed. That means the algorithm is going to be good to order delta t squared. But of course, when you go back to this form of things, all right, so when I act with this m times, then the error that I make is, of course, going to be m delta t cubed, which m is, of course, t over delta t. And that means that the error in a full trajectory is actually delta t squared. All right? So you sort of have to be careful about the difference between the local error and the global error in a long trajectory. All right, nevertheless, this is something whose action I can evaluate, right? Well, that's a lot of detail. So let me sort of show you that on the slides, right? Give you an idea of how we do it. Oh, it relies on a couple of simple operator identities. Here? Yes, I do. Okay. So in order to, let's see, we saw all of this. Okay. So, all right. So here's what my operator expansion now actually looks like. Okay. So this is the IL2, IL1, and IL2. And what I claim I have to do is I have to act on the full set of positions and momenta, which you see stacked up here. I have to act on the initial values of these. Okay, now what does that require that I do? Okay, well, let's look at some simple operator calculus here that we have to do. Okay, the first kind of operator that I encounter is basically like this. What if I have e to the c d by dx acting on x? C is just a constant, or something that's independent of x, all right? Well, the way I can see how I might do that is a simple Taylor expansion. So I write out the exponential as 1 plus c by dx, d by dx, 1 half c squared, second derivative, acting on x. Okay, 1 is just 1. That gives me x back again. D by dx of x is, of course, 1. So that's going to give me x plus c. And then, of course, the second derivative of x is 0. So it's the third derivative and the fourth derivative. So really, only the first two terms here survive. And I just get a translation. X goes to x plus c under the action of that operator. Okay. What about if I have a function of x? Well, it's a little harder. In order to do that, I need the full Taylor expansion of this operator. So I write it like this. And, of course, the kth derivative of f may not be 0, so I just get the kth derivative. So I get, at the end of the day, 1 over k factorial, c to the k, and the kth derivative of f. Actually, that's a Taylor series expansion itself. That is a Taylor series expansion of f of x plus c about c equals 0. Not x equals 0, but c equals 0. Okay. All right. Take out a piece of paper. I'm going to actually have you do something now before we go on. Okay, let's see if you guys actually kind of get this operator algebra idea. Okay, we're going to take probably about maybe 5 minutes. All right, here's your first little exercise. Try the Taylor expansion approach to this. See what you get. if you have an answer, raise your hand when you get an answer. You got it? What do you think it is?
X plus C times X squared.
Nope. Try again. Anybody else? Yeah. Say again?
E to the C.
Yes. All right, he got it. E to the C times X. That is correct. Good job. Okay. You know, the way you see that is you expand this into Taylor series. And there's a K factorial. Well, if you just write out the first few terms of this, it's 1 plus cx d by dx plus a half c squared x d dx of x d dx on x. Okay. That whole thing is on x. Better write it like this. Okay. Plus dot, dot, dot. The first term is just x. The second one is c times x, because d by dx of x is 1. All right. The third term is a half c squared. I have d by dx on x, which is 1, d by dx on this x, which is 1, and then x left over. And the third term, if you work it out, will be 1 over 3 factorial c cubed x, because we'll have the same pattern of derivatives, so there'll just be 3 of them. So at the end of the day, what you get is x times a sum, k equals 0 to infinity, c to the k, over k factorial, which is just x e to the c. So it's a scaling operator. Instead of translating it, it actually scales it. And you should be able to convince yourself that if you had f of x there, it would just be f of x e to the c. OK, if you get that, then you get the hang of all this operator stuff. And usually, that's kind of the most difficult level of operators that you need. OK, so let me proceed now. Now that we know what these operators do, let's look at the action that we have. So I'm just going to consider one particle, make the notation easier. So one position, one momentum, and I want to see what it produces at delta t, acting like this. So the first thing is this operator. F is a function of r. So as far as p is concerned, it's a constant. So we know already that all this does is it translates the momentum by an amount of c. Here c is delta t over 2 times f. It does nothing to r. It has no effect on r. So it's like an identity on r. So then I have to take this state, and I have to act with that operator on it. OK, so I act with this operator on that state. And what that does is everywhere I see r, I replace it by r plus delta t over 2, delta t times p over m. So here I have an r, and I replace it this way. Remember, everything is, I have these zeros in here to remind me that it's at the initial state. OK, so I translate r. And then the last operator is this. Once again, this operator acting on that state. That means everywhere I see p, I replace it by p plus delta t over 2 times f. So that gives me overall this scheme. All right. So here I see a p. I replace it with its translated form. I have a p there, gets its translated form. And then here as well. OK. Now what that is, in fact, when you kind of write it out, is this. And that is the velocity relay integrator back again, but derived in a very, very simple way. All right, so now we see very explicitly why velocity relay is time reversible, measure preserving, and symplectic, because it came directly from a factorized form of our operator, e to the ilt. OK. Now, here's the great thing about the operator form. This is why it's so actually so powerful, is that I never need to do all that algebra that we just looked at, which is why I didn't do it on the board, because I don't want you to have a permanent record of it, all right, in your notes. You never, ever, ever need to do that stuff, all right? It was just to show you what it actually does. At the end of the day, all you need to do is to look at the operators that you have, and you can actually write down the code directly. So let's look at this set of operators here. We know what everything does. The first thing is a momentum translation, a position translation, and then a momentum translation. So in fact, I can translate this directly into code. Here I'm going to write it as a little pseudocode. So I loop over all my particles, I equals 1 to n. And the first thing that I do is I just do a momentum translation by an amount, a half times the time step times the force. And that becomes my new momentum. Right? So my first instruction in code would be p plus equals 0.5 times delta t times f. Right? Then I look at the second operator, and I see that that actually is a position translation. So whatever momentum I have from the first step gets fed into the second step. I take r plus delta t times p over m. That gives me the new r. Now the r has changed. So in order to evaluate this operator, I need to update the force, because that's the force evaluated at whatever r came out of there. So I end my position loop. I call my force calculator that does an update to the forces. And then with those new forces, I do exactly this step again. No need to work through any operator algebra. No need to work through finite difference equations. I don't need to know what they are in this case. I just write down the pseudocode directly from the operators. And that makes this approach really powerful. OK, now I'm going to show you why this is so powerful. It leads me directly to multiple time step methods. OK, so here's an example of a very complicated molecule. It's got lots of bonds and bends and dihedral angles and things that are present in that force field that I showed you early on. So let's imagine a very simple paradigm here. Let's imagine I'm going to do this all with one particle in one dimension to keep the notation simple for now. And let's suppose that my force has two contributions, right? I'm going to call them a fast contribution and a slow contribution. In the scheme of my force field, the fast contribution might be bond stretching and angle bending and maybe even dihedral angle motion. The slow part could be intermolecular interactions, all right? So dispersion forces, Coulomb forces, and things of that nature. And of course, what's interesting about this way that I divide the forces is that I assume that the fast forces are really, really, really cheap to evaluate computationally. Harmonic oscillators can be evaluated very quickly. Whereas the slow forces are pairwise. So they're going to be sort of like, you know, n squared if you do it the dumb way, or with lists. It's still a very expensive order n calculation. On the other hand, on the time scale of my fast forces, the slow forces don't change very much. So what I would like to do is to evaluate the fast forces more frequently than the slow forces, to do these sort of every n steps, where n is some small number. But I want to do this in a way that preserves my time reversibility, my symplectic nature of my algorithm, all those things about classical mechanics that I like. OK. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to write down my Liouville operator like this. I'm going to collect the kinetic term and the fast force term into one operator that I call ILREF. It defines for me some kind of reference system in which only the fast force is present. That's still a full Hamiltonian system, all right? But it ignores the effect of the slow forces, which I then put into a second term that I call IL slow. OK. And so the way I'm going to factorize my propagator, a la Trotter, is to pull the slow operator to the outside, the reference in the middle, and the slow operator to the outside. Still good to order delta t cubed. The delta t that I have in here, by the way, is assumed to be appropriate for my slow force. And that's OK, because here I've written the exact propagator for the reference system. But of course, I don't know how to evaluate that. All right? So here comes the multiple time stepping part. I'm going to introduce a second time step, little delta t, which is assumed to be appropriate for the reference system, this fast force. And what I'm going to do is I assume that the ratio between this little delta t and this big delta t is n. Or sorry, the other way around. That time step to that time step, the ratio is this n. So if I evaluate this thing little n times, then I get back that time step delta t. All right. Now what I can do with this little reference thing is I can also break it up into a trotter factorized form, where I have the forces on the outside and the position part in the middle. And I do this little n times. Right? So what I'm doing goes back to my first slide, my little cogs and gears. All right? So I turn the crank on this thing, I turn the wheel on this thing little n times. And it only means I have to evaluate the cheap, fast force. And then every n steps, I have to do a big time step move where I evaluate the slow force. That's an example of multiple time stepping with two steps. All right? OK. So that's my scheme. And now I can actually go directly into pseudocode. I don't need to work through finite difference equations. How would I write the pseudocode? All right, well, I look at everything. I know how it acts. That's a translation operator. So the first step in my algorithm is to change the momenta by an amount given by only the slow force. Now I open up a loop for these little n steps. And the first thing is a translation of momenta by the fast force and the little step. Change the positions. That's that operator there, again by the little step. Now I have a force update, but it's only the fast force, so it's the cheap force. I have a momentum translation, and now I close that loop. I go around this n times, and then at the end of the day, I have to update the slow force with whatever positions came out of this loop, and then I can do a translation of momenta by the slow force. No need to work through any finite difference equations. I just look at my operators, I write the code. All right? OK, so now how do we do things practically for real simulations? So now we go to the case where I have an n-particle system. And typically, most force fields kind of force you to face the fact that you really have three time scales at least. And those are given by intramolecular forces, so bonds, bends, and torsions. Short-range forces, OK, now these are non-bonded forces that experience sort of the steep rise of the Leonard-Jones potential. So typically, these are going to be forces that act within a certain small cutoff, say maybe 5 angstroms or so. And then everything else is called long range. OK. So there we go. 4 contains all my chemical bonded forces, my short-range forces, and my long-range forces. OK, everything past this short-range cutoff. So what I want to do is to use three time steps in this. So I'll call the three steps h, little delta t, and big delta t. And the operator that I would write down would look like this. All right? So here, I turn the crank on my intramolecular forces n times. Then I correct with the short-range forces. And I do this whole thing m times. All right? So again, we're turning the little wheels, a bigger wheel. And then at the outer part, I have just my long-range force. OK. I think you could, in the same way, write the code for something like that. It's just the same basic idea. I know what everything in here does. I can write the algorithm. So let's look at some results. So how does this actually improve things for a typical system? So this is a simulation from a paper we wrote some time ago now on all-atom butane. All-atom butane contains bond stretching, bending motion, there's one dihedral angle in it, and then intermolecular forces. And we use the energy conservation as a measure of how well the algorithm does. Obviously, it's a numerical scheme, so energy isn't perfectly conserved anymore. All right? But typically, what we want is if I measure the energy conservation this way, which is the energy at the kth step minus the initial energy normalized by the initial energy, we kind of want that to be on the order of about 10 to the minus 4 or so. All right? Now if I evaluate this, let's say for, so here I'm using two time steps, just intramolecular and the short and long range are together. So it's just an intramolecular force separation. So if I do a half a femtosecond time step, that's my energy conservation measure. It's actually pretty good, about where I want it to be. Now let's look at some multiple time stepping cases. Here's one femtosecond for delta t, and the little time step is four times smaller than that. And obviously, I improve things. So I want to start pushing the outer time step. If I go to 2 and 8, then, of course, the energy conservation degrades a little bit, but I'm still below that value. If I go to 3 and 12, now I'm kind of comparable to where I was before. All right, so that's about where I would stop. Notice that if I try to go to 4 and 16, there's suddenly a pretty big jump in the energy conservation. All right, we're going to come back to why this happens. But that sort of puts a hard limit on what my outer time step can be. It's about 3 femtoseconds. All right? So the gain in computational time here over this is about a factor of 6. All right? So I get a factor of 6, right? Because of the fact that the intramolecular forces here are so cheap to evaluate. Here's another one. This is where I'm using the full 3 time step scheme. All right? Intra, short, and long. This is the HIV protease complex with a particular drug called sequinivir. And okay, you can see that, again, if I have one femtosecond time step, one time step scheme, I get about, again, 1.6 times 10 to the minus 4, which is pretty good. Now I start increasing the time step. So let's say I go here, 2 femtoseconds. One long-range force and 4 intermolecular forces, I'm still pretty good. So now I start increasing this number, 4 and 2 and 4 for long-range and intermolecular. I'm still pretty good. I can see I can go all the way out to about 8 femtoseconds, okay, which saves me, again, a factor of about 5 to 6 in this case. And I'm comparable to where I was before. If I try to go any higher than that, again, the energy conservation breaks down. Right? So that's something we're going to come to in the second half. Why does that actually happen? There really is a limit beyond which you cannot go in the time step for these sort of conventional schemes that we have. Okay. Let me just finish up the last 5 minutes discussing something a little bit different from Newtonian dynamics. And this is a very typical thing called Langevin dynamics. How many people have heard of Langevin dynamics? A few people have. Langevin dynamics is a way to generate a canonical or Boltzmann distribution of your Hamiltonian. All right, so in statistical mechanics, this is an important thing because it's the distribution of the canonical ensemble. It allows us to introduce temperature into our simulation and sort of preserve that temperature. Okay. And an equation of motion that will do this for you is a stochastic differential equation. All right, so it looks sort of Newtonian, except there's a dissipative term here in my momentum equation. This gamma is a friction term. And then I have in here a stochastic or random force term, which is sigma dw. This sigma is determined by the friction and the temperature that I want and the particle's mass. Right? If the force were equal to 0 in this case, these would be the equations of Brownian dynamics. Okay. Well, we can actually do a Liouville operator approach to this. It's not a Hamiltonian system, but I still have an operator structure. I can use it. So I write down all the different terms in my equations of motion, the kinetic term, the deterministic force term, and then the dissipative and the stochastic term I'm collecting into this operator called ILOU for Ornstein-Ohlenbeck, which is what this kind of process is. The scheme I'm going to show you very quickly is one due to Limekuhler and Matthews. All right, so just a couple years ago, they proposed this. And they showed that if you do a breakup very much like what I just showed you, where you have IL2 on the outside, IL1, and then you sandwich everything with the OU operator, the stochastic part, in the middle. All right, so as a way to kind of remember these operators, since the string gets a little longer here, they denoted this one BAOAB. So this is called the Baobab factorization. All right, Baobab. All right. Well, I can figure out what the action of this operator is. On R, it does nothing. And if I use the stochastic calculus, I can figure out that this operator has a momentum scaling term and then a term that looks like this, where R is just a Gaussian random number of 0 mean and unit width. Okay, so that's what that operator does to the momentum. And they did they showed an example of a little one-dimensional potential like that. And this is actually the error in the energy conservation that they get in different friction limits, weak friction and strong friction. Okay, so here's the Bayouab. Here's another one where you simply reverse the A and the B operators. It's called a boba, all right? And it turns out it actually makes a difference if you do that. So a boba turns out to have a higher error overall than Bayouab. So they actually recommend the Bayouab operator as the way to go. And here's the distribution that you get, all right? And the solid line is the exact result, and the canonical ensemble says e to the minus beta u. And in fact, the Bayouab operator, which is the symbols here, actually gives you a very, very good reproduction of that, whereas the Aboba operator doesn't do quite as well. All right, so the different lines here are different time steps that you might have from this graph here. And you can see that, in fact, with the Aboba operator, you just don't do as well. Other operators that come from numerical analysis textbooks, SPV, I'm not sure what that stands for, and BBK, these are very standard techniques. They actually really suck. Right? So you're better off to go with this operator approach than kind of any of the standard approaches that you might pick out of your numerical methods textbook. Okay, now multiple time stepping with Langevin dynamics is trivial once you have this operator factorization. Again, if I have a fast plus slow decomposition, all I have to do is do the same thing, but I just have my OU operator sandwiched in between my position updates. Otherwise, it looks exactly the same. All right, and in fact, this is the kind of scheme that you can use with dissipative particle dynamics. So I showed you this picture early on. Dissipative particle dynamics is just fancy Langevin dynamics. So the way DPD works is, again, you have my conservative forces from those things I showed you on the first slide. I have a friction term. The value of it actually just depends on how far apart the particles are. So it's a little bit position dependent. And some switching function that says that it looks like this, or r less than some cutoff, otherwise it's zero. And I have a stochastic term, which also is only operational if the particles are closer than this rc. That's it. It's basically Langevin dynamics with a little cutoff in it. That's all it is. And this would be the scheme that you would use then for dissipative particle dynamics with multiple time stepping. Right? So now that I've shown you Langevin dynamics, DPD is essentially exactly the same thing. Okay, I think this is a good place for us to stop. So we'll come back afterward and we'll look at some more advanced ideas. And then I'm going to show you at the end how to go to really big time steps with this idea. Right, okay, so just let me quickly summarize from last time. And then we're going to have another exercise to do. So, all right. So the first thing we saw is that you have motion on many time scales, and this is ubiquitous. Comes up in Newtonian dynamics, comes up in dissipative particle dynamics, Langevin dynamics, coarse-grained dynamics. And at the end of the day, what we need to do is to bridge very, very long time scales from very, very short time steps in our simulations. If you want to derive integrators for the equations of motion, I strongly recommend starting with this operator approach rather than trying to find the right way to do the Taylor series and generate your finite difference equations that way. That's an approach that's going to be fraught with difficulties, especially when you get to things that are non-Newtonian in nature, like Langevin dynamics. Okay. Well, we saw that multiple time step integrators can be derived using the operator approach. No need to write down finite difference equations. I just go directly from the operator to the pseudocode, and eventually to the code. And I can kind of increase the time step by a factor of about 5 to 10, typically giving me a gain in computational efficiency of maybe about a factor of 5, typically. All right. So now in this lecture, we're going to see at the end of it how to push things far beyond this limit. All right, so there is a kind of a hard limit on these conventional approaches, but we can actually beat that limit. And it comes from these problems come from something we're going to discuss called resonances. And so if we use what are called resonance-free methods, we can beat this time step limit. All right. Before doing that, however, I want to see if you guys sort of get the idea of this directly translating from operators into code. And so let's do, again, take out a piece of paper, and let's do a little exercise. All right, there it is. Okay, so here are the two operators for Newtonian dynamics that we wrote down. IL1 is the kinetic term. IL2 is due to the force. And we looked at the BAD operator, so 2, 1, 2. But now I'm changing it up on you. I'm saying let's do 1, 2, 1. Okay? Write down the pseudocode from that operator factorization that you would get. All right, so let's take maybe 3 minutes to do that. Shouldn't take too long. Let's see what you come up with. Who has an answer? Anybody have it yet? Okay, raise your hand if you have an answer.
What? Isn't the earlier pseudocode called 0.5 R'?
Say it again.
So I don't remember what exactly the equation was before you used.
Okay, so why don't you read me the code that you have? What did you write down?
So P is P plus delta P into drag.
The first thing should actually be a position update, because it's either the IL1, right? Position, momentum, position. Always have this, the first step. Okay, so the first thing has to be, in this case, a position update, because it's the IL1 operator. Okay, then, of course, we need to get an update to our forces. Then we come in with the new forces. I get a momentum update. And then finally a position update. Okay. So you should make sure you understand how that goes. Yeah?
So do I understand correctly that this is one iteration, then you do the same thing?
This is just one step. That gets you to the next set of positions.
Okay.
Obviously, up here, there has to be an overall, you know.
Okay, then the question is, why do you separate these two position updates? Why don't you just put them together in one? Because, I mean, the last position update is right before the first position update of the next iteration. If you just put them both together, you can...
You could do that. You could do that. It won't save you anything. The reason not to do that is that here you have the positions and the momenta at the same time, which means you can calculate things, all right? If you have them out of sync, then whenever you want to calculate something, you have to bring them into sync again. So it doesn't make a lot of sense to have them out of sync. You're right, you could do that, but this is better because you have them at the same time. Okay, so this is what you should have got. This is the kind of thing you want to make sure that you understand how to do. If you get that, then all this operator stuff is really, really easy. Okay, so now let's talk about some real uses of this stuff before we get to the more advanced approaches. Okay, so this is part two. Whoops, obviously I have to turn on the display. Yeah, part two. Okay, so I showed you this picture at the beginning, all right, which is a very, very straightforward approach to MD from the David Shaw group, all right? And I know David Shaw personally, we're good friends, and every time I see David Shaw, I tell him, you know, you guys did great with this straightforward MD stuff, but really think about how much more powerful your computer could be, your very, very fast computer, it being the only one that can reach microsecond timescales, if you were willing to do some enhanced sampling approaches, right? Something that would accelerate the MD beyond what you could do with just your very fast computer. All right, and he kind of, I think, gets it, but so we looked at this slide also at the beginning, and again it shows us what's the real bottleneck to being able to bridge time scales, and it's this rough energy landscape idea. Okay, so let me give you just some applications that illustrate the use of enhanced sampling techniques. So this is a very simple little peptide, all right? It's called metencephalin. It's a 5-residue peptide, all right? It has some kind of bulky side chains in it that make sampling difficult. And this is a paper that we actually just had accepted into PNAS on enhanced sampling for peptides like this and larger. All right? We use this as a kind of illustrative approach. And at the end of the day, what we were able to get, and I'll talk about how we do this a little bit later, what we were able to get is a map of all of the key points that represent sort of archetypal structures, all right? Now, the red points here are stable minima, and the blue points represent transitions, all right, between the different states. And we put everything on a big network or graph like this, and we find that the points that represent minima and transitions kind of cluster into regions that we can assign to archetypal structures. Now, these are the stable structures of this guy. Some of them look like, you know, structures like this that are kind of coil-like. Some of them are partial helical structures like this. Some of them are kind of hairpin turn. And then you have things that are intermediate between these two. It's a very rich landscape at the end of the day. And finally, what we were able to do once we had these points mapped out is to compute their relative free energies. So from that, I could tell you the free energy difference in going from any structure that you see here to any other structure. All right, so all possible free energy differences were available. That's the kind of thing you'd like to be able to do. But in order to do it, you need to have a lot of statistics on the process that you're looking at. And in David Shaw's research, he doesn't have statistics. He gets a very long simulation. But because of this rare event signature, it's extremely difficult to really calculate something observable for his folding transitions. OK, so let's talk about how we get there. Here's actually just another little example before we get into it. This is illustrating crystal polymorphism. All right, so it's that benzene crystal that we looked at. And what I'm showing you here, in addition to the solid, is the box itself. And the box, as you can see, is allowed to move in this simulation. And it moves in such a way that it actually drives the molecules between the different polymorphs that it has. And so not only do I get the crystal structures, but I actually get the shape of the unit cell, which is one of the things that's important in reporting a crystal structure. You need the space group, and you need the shape of the unit cell, so the cell lengths and the cell angles. Once I have the shape of the cell and the space group, I have the full crystal structure specified. So at the end of the day, from a trajectory like this, I can actually analyze it, and I can get all the different structures that we find. These are the unit cell shapes, the space groups that go with them, and the relative probabilities under a given set of conditions. So this is at a particular temperature and pressure, so a particular point in my phase diagram. And the green line here is actually showing the relative free energies of all the structures. That's the kind of thing I'd like to be able to predict if I'm going to report a bunch of crystal polymorphs. What is their relative free energy? Okay. It turns out that there are many, many polymorphic pharmaceutical compounds, some of them more common than others. So for example, this one here is called ranitidine hydrochloride, also goes under the name of Zantac. It's something you take, everyone takes every day for common heartburn, all right? Aspirin is another one that's actually polymorphic. Or this anti-cancer drug, 5-fluorouracil, is another one which is actually fairly polymorphic. In some cases, the polymorphs are bioavailable. In some cases, they're not. As I said, this is the kind of thing you want to know beforehand before you actually go to market with your drug. OK. I mentioned this idea of the blind structure prediction test. So the Cambridge database issues this test every, I think, 4 years. They're up to number 6 now. And these are the molecules of the blind test. So they give you this information. You know what the molecule looks like, and that's it. And you're supposed to, from this information, actually predict what the crystal structures are. All right? They don't tell you what the experimentally known structure is. And the one who gets closest wins the competition. So you have one like this, which is a fairly rigid molecule. They give you molecules with some amount of internal flexibility. There's also one that's a hydrate, very, very difficult to do because you don't know how much water you need to put in. They even have a co-crystal. So these two things actually crystallize together. So predict the crystal structure of that. Actually twice as hard because it's a co-crystal. And then so there's always some big beast that has, you know, a lot of different bulky groups and flexibility and everything that you don't like about crystal structure prediction is in there. OK. So let's talk about the kind of approach, and we'll see why multiple time stepping becomes important in this. All right? So the way we approach this problem is through the idea of coarse graining. All right? Coarse graining is a way of representing the key structures in your system, let's say the things that are most important, in terms of a small set of what we call coarse-grained variables. Here, these are called collective variables, all right? And they are functions of the primitive atomic coordinates that we've been talking about. So what might these be for some of the examples I showed you? Well, if you were doing a peptide, for example, like this, this is the alanine dipeptide, any biochemistry textbook will show you that the two variables that are kind of key interest are these two dihedral angles. These are called the Ramachandran angles. And if you plot a free energy in them, you get something that looks like this, all right? So you see very definite regions in blue that represent the stable structures of these guys, and they're sort of helical and beta-like structures. And then you see very high regions, and you can clearly see saddles, all right, between these different minima. Here, here, here's a saddle, there's a saddle. Saddles are also of different free energy. And so this is the kind of thing you'd like to be able to predict. Well, this is a very nice coarse-grained representation of all that stuff that's in that small peptide. For crystals, one, again, we might use the shape of the cell, so the three vectors that represent the overall shape. And I collect them in a little 3x3 matrix, generally call that H. So H is a variable of interest. I might be interested in how things pack. All right, so there are variables that represent that. These are called Steinhardt order parameters. All these things that I have here are examples of what we call these collective variables, and they're things that I call generically by this name Q. And what we want to do, and when we coarse grain a system, is to represent the energy in terms of these Qs. Well, that energy is called a free energy. All right, in statistical mechanics, that free energy comes from something called a marginal probability distribution function. So once I have this, then I have a full coarse-grained representation of my system. Rigorously, this is what would describe the energy in terms of my coarse-grained variables, what I call little s1 and little sn. The way I get this is as follows. So I have my Hamiltonian, which we looked at. I integrate over the full set of coordinates and momenta. And what I want to do then is to restrict these collective variables to have certain values, s, all right? And when I calculate this in classical statistical mechanics, I get something called the marginal probability distribution. If I take the log of that distribution and multiply by the temperature, I get the free energy surface. And that's the thing that describes the interactions of my system at this coarse grain level. These S's can actually, these Q's can be anything you want them to be. So this is also a way to coarse grain your system if you want to use you know, for example, interaction sites and things like that. They don't actually have to be these fancy things that I showed you. They can be whatever you want them to be. Okay. Now, no one likes to see delta functions in their formulas, so, and we don't either. And so for use in the computer, we represent these delta functions as the limits of Gaussians. All right? So Gaussian functions, when you make them very narrow and very high, actually become delta functions. But for the numerical usage, we would actually let these inverse width parameters, which I have to take to infinity to get the delta function, we'd let them be finite, big but finite. Oh, what I do is, when I put this back in here, I actually get the exponential of something that looks kind of like a harmonic oscillator. All right, this term in the exponential kind of looks like a harmonic oscillator. So I can put that into my Hamiltonian as a kind of new interaction term. Now the idea is I want to use classical mechanics as a way to sample this distribution and therefore produce my free energy surface. The easiest way to do that, rather than trying to lay down a grid in terms of these variables, is to actually move these centers around dynamically. So I do that by introducing kinetic energy for them. It's completely fictitious, but it allows me to sample this distribution using the mechanics of this extended Hamiltonian, which depends on positions, momenta, and then the centers and their momenta as well. And so I write down equations of motion for these guys, and they look like this. All right? Now, the key to getting enhanced sampling is to use temperature. All right? Now, the distribution is e to the minus beta h, so that gives me the probability of having a certain energy represented by the Hamiltonian. And in order to get over barriers, I want to make that probability higher. Well, one way I can do that is to increase the temperature. But I have to do that carefully. I can't just increase the temperature without changing the thermodynamic state. So what I do is I let these fictitious variables actually carry the high temperature. The physical variables are still kept at the physical temperature. But through this harmonic coupling, wherever these centers go, they're going to bring the collective variables with them. All right. So if these guys are moving at high temperature, then I'm actually driving these collective variables to cross the barriers. And if in addition I make these centers heavy by introducing high masses for them, then what I can prove under these conditions is that the distribution that I get, which I call this adiabatic distribution because I have this kind of adiabatic separation between these guys and these guys, is actually the true marginal distribution but raised to a power which is the ratio of the two temperatures. So that if I take the log of this guy and I multiply by that high temperature, I actually just get the log of this times kT, and that is the true free energy at the physical temperature. It was sort of a magic formula that allows me to recover the actual free energy using temperature as a way of accelerating the dynamics. Okay. So let me show you a little example of this. By the way, just a couple of things that we've done since then is we've shown that you can combine this with the very popular metadynamics method as a way of introducing extra acceleration. And we've shown that there are optimal ways to reconstruct the free energy. Kind of technical, so I'm not going to go into that. But let me show you this little example of the alanine decamer again, which I showed you earlier. But now we can see how it's actually working. So in this case, I use all the Ramachandran pairs. So that's 20 collective variables. All right, that gives me a very high free energy surface, so a high dimensional free energy surface. So we're going to have to see how to deal with that. All right, we'll come back to that point a little later. My two temperatures and my mass scale. Well, and at the end of the day, that's what allows me to simulate this thing and actually drive it between all these different states that we saw. Okay, so for example, the helical state that we see a lot of, the beta hairpin, which we'll see briefly, I think. Like there. All right. And all the other configurations that you see as well with this. And so when I compare, for example, the RMSD to the native state, the red here is just straightforward MD, like what David Shaw would do. And then the black is with this accelerated approach. Right? So straightforward MD, basically, you're going to see the characteristic signature of a rare event. The transition to the helical state, but I get only one in this trajectory. Here's a trajectory where it happens in the beginning and then stays there. Here's one where I never see it. Here's another one where I never see it. In the case of the accelerated approach, I get lots of transitions between the helical state and other states as well, enough that I may be able to start collecting statistics on this process. And that's what I need. All right? One event doesn't give me anything. Many events gives me something. OK. Here's how I would do it with crystals. Don't worry too much about these equations that you're seeing here. This is just a standard constant pressure molecular dynamics algorithm, but now with the temperatures introduced as well as my collective variables. The key thing to note about these equations only is that I have an equation of motion for the cell matrix, the cell vectors and angles, or if you like, the individual vectors, and it's driven by the differences between the instantaneous pressure estimator, which is given by this expression, and the pressure that I want from my phase diagram. Okay. I'm going to show you a little example, actually, where we applied this approach not to crystallization, but to the opposite process of melting, actually. This is something we just had published in Science a couple months ago. So melting is a nucleation process, right? So the classic explanation of nucleation actually comes from something called nucleation theory. And nucleation theory is a very simple theory. It says that the free energy for the phase transition, for a melting or freezing transition, in this case, is given by two terms. One is a volume term, all right? So it says I have to form a sphere of liquid of, let's say, a radius r. And delta mu is the chemical potential difference between the solid and the liquid forms. And normally, it's negative if you're at the melting point. So that term tends to be negative, and it says you gain free energy as a result of creating this little nucleus. But you have to pay a penalty for having an interface between solid and liquid, which is unfavorable. And that's given by the surface area of the sphere that you're forming and the surface tension of the liquid. Okay? And if you plot this little free energy profile as a function of r, you see that there's a barrier to reaching a critical nucleus size, is given by this expression here. And then it's downhill once you get there to the liquid state. All right, but first you have this very high barrier that you have to cross. So that's the classic classic explanation of how things melt or freeze. Right? Okay, we use this approach to study the melting of a system of copper. All right, so this is a simulation with a something called an embedded atom model. Oops, sorry about that. And it's a system of, I think in this case, about 3,000 copper atoms. So it's a pretty big system. And as you watch this, you'll see a variety of melting and refreezing transitions. You'll see partial melting and then refreezing. And you'll see a variety of different structures forming as we undergo these melting and freezing transitions. Okay, the shape of the box is changing, and the overall packing. And in fact, my collective variables in this case are the shape of the cell and these two Steinhardt order parameters that I talked about. And my accelerated temperature is about 10 to the 7th Kelvin. The physical temperature here is just the melting temperature. Okay, now at the end of the day, we can turn all this stuff into free energy information. And the reason that we got this into science is that we got a very different picture of melting from actually getting real pathways for this system than nucleation theory would predict. So here's a picture of our free energy projected into a two-dimensional surface. This is the Q4 parameter, which is sort of telling us about the packing of that particular solid, and then the volume. And what you can see that there's a very large basin here that results from the solid form. And in that basin, there are two sub-basins. And one of them is a very interesting one that I'm going to talk about in a minute. And then there's a saddle. And then we go to the liquid state. Now, what's happening as we go from this base, this sub-basin to this sub-basin? So up here, we have a perfect crystal with no defects. What we get coming in here is a system of a solid in which we're starting to form defects. Now, remember, we're at the melting temperature. And the defects that we can form in a solid are very typical ones. They're interstitials, so something coming into between lattice points, and then vacancies. All right, so I'm sort of illustrating these things here. Now, it turns out that these defects are incredibly mobile. All right, they actually diffuse at a very high rate. And so what happens is two defects can meet, and they can either annihilate if they're of the opposite type, an interstitial meeting a vacancy, or they can start to aggregate if they're of the same type. So interstitials meeting interstitials, or vacancies meeting vacancies. And what happens is that these defects, as they aggregate, they form a little nucleus. Now, the reason that this is different from nucleation theory is that nucleation theory says that the nucleus grows from the outside, from the inside out. Our picture suggests that the nucleus actually grows from the outside in. It grows because all these defects are forming at one particular place in the liquid. And there is a very large barrier to that process. Then I get to a little minimum where I kind of start to form a stable cluster. More defects come in, that cluster grows. And then I get to the critical nucleus size, and finally I go to the liquid state. Right? So that's actually one pathway that we form. And its free energy is very different from that of nucleation theory. Here's another one where there's another pathway in which I have a dislocation type of defect like this. All right, so I have like a line defect. And that's actually a place where it's easy to nucleate a cluster. So you actually see that happening here. And then at that dislocation, the cluster grows. And then I can make the transition to the liquid state. All right, but there were a lot of barriers on the way, first to form the dislocation, then to grow the size of the nucleus at that dislocation, and finally to get to the critical nucleus size. Yeah?
Can you give us again the intuition? Why do we get these valleys? I don't understand. At point one, so the lower right picture, the first hill, one. So we have a hill, and why do we go down that?
So I get the hill. Oh, why does it actually go here?
Yeah.
These little basins are really just local minima formed when a cluster starts to stabilize. It doesn't really have a lot of meaning. A free energy surface is a very rugged thing that has local minima that are sort of easy to access and also easy to climb out of. So I start to form, let's say here, a couple of clusters that are kind of stable. Right? They're not critical yet, but they are kind of stable. These actually, in this case, these finally turn into these line dislocations. So as I start to aggregate these defect clusters, then they actually change their shape. They grow into line dislocations. And that's what brings me to the second little basin right here, where the dislocations are stable. All right? Then I start to aggregate at the dislocations new nuclei. That's that little basin there. Okay? And then at the end of the day, you know, there's, again, another one where I might have a larger nucleus forming. What really is important is that basin there where I go to the liquid. So all of this ruggedness, it's just little intermediate metastable states that I visit. Okay. Now let's talk a little bit about high dimensionality and how we deal with it. So I can generate these. Oh, and by the way, so let me just come back to the equations of motion quickly just to show you that this stiff harmonic force, remember this kappa has to be very large, is something that I can actually do with multiple time stepping, and I do. All right, so this harmonic force is very cheap, was very fast. So I can use one time step for this, and then I use one time step for basically everything else. All right, which I can also further subdivide into multiple time steps if I want all of the schemes that we looked at in the last lecture. So here I have an intrinsic multiple time scale problem that I created for enhanced sampling, and I can get the advantage of large time steps by just saying I'm going to integrate that with a really small one. Okay, important point because that's why we're here. All right. So very quickly, when I have a very high dimensional surface, I don't want to represent the whole thing because I can't. I have no way of looking at something really that's beyond a two-dimensional surface. And yet here I'm generating 6, 7, 10, 20 dimensional surfaces. How do I even start to look at something like that? Well, I don't. All right. What I say is that the important thing on any high dimensional surface is not the full surface itself, but really only the minima and the saddle points. All right. So if I go back, well, this is what we were looking at before. This is the alanine dipeptide surface. And all I really care about are these dark areas where I have minima and areas like this where I have a saddle. If I can characterize those, I have most of the information of my surface, of my landscape that I care about. So we introduce a little scheme that's based on these fast forces as a way of getting the coarse graining job done. And again, it's an intrinsic multiple time scale problem. So this is called an activation step. And it uses these Gaussian centers as a way to start in a minimum and climb up to a saddle, all right, one that I might have here or here or here. And it's based on an eigenvector following scheme. It's called gentlest descent dynamics. And it uses a force and a Hessian matrix. All right? Now, the direction of the force is determined by a projection onto an eigenvector of the Hessian. What we want this eigenvector to be is actually the lowest eigenvector of the Hessian. But I don't want to diagonalize the Hessian explicitly. So I introduce a dynamics for it, which is based on, again, taking the Hessian on an eigenvector, projecting out everything else but the lowest one. And then if the force were parallel to that eigenvector, then this expression here would exactly reverse the sign of the force, and I would climb up based on the direction of the lowest Hessian eigenvector. Okay. Normally, the force isn't exactly parallel to it, so this gives me a projection of the force onto that direction and allows me to climb up along the direction of gentlest ascent. Okay? So that's what these equations do. And I get trajectories that look just like what I'm seeing here. Once I get to a saddle, then I can use just standard relaxation to go back, let's say, into another basin, let's say down here, or to start here and maybe to go along the blue one into that basin there. So I have activation and relaxation steps. Now, the forces and the Hessians that come from this actually use these harmonic forces. So if I do the average of this harmonic force, I actually get the free energy gradient, which is the F that goes in there. Or if I do a covariance matrix of that harmonic force, then I get the Hessian that goes in there. In order to get these averages, I actually have to do a lot of local small time step simulations with the collective variables fixed at particular values of these S's, right, wherever I am. I do this on the fly. So I have one time step for this. And then my other time step, my big time step, is used for these activation and relaxation equations here. So it really is a multi-scale type of approach. OK, and that's what allowed me to do this metenkephalin example. And when I actually did it, I got a set of 1,000 minima and about 1,500 saddles, which I arranged into a graph that initially looked like this. And we said, I can't make any sense of that. That is a representation of my high-dimensional surface, but it's still pretty hard to look at. So the way that we actually got this to make sense, and what gave me that picture that I showed you early on in the first lecture, is to use a scheme called the sketch map method. Well, sketch map tries to look for features in a very complicated system like this or this associated graph. And basically what it does is it says, we have an objective functional which is based on, this is a little switching function, so it's a sigmoid function. And Rij is the difference, the distance between backbone carbon atoms on my peptide chain. This little f is also a sigmoid function. And its argument is distances between points of my graph. So based on the structures that I get here, I'm going to map them onto the points of this graph that I see here. So I try to minimize that functional. And at the end of the day, I can rearrange the graph based on what I get. And it looks like this thing that we looked at. And I can pull out the archetypal structures. And then I can use the enhanced sampling approaches that we talked about based on temperature to give me all these free energy differences. So it's really a two-step scheme. The first one is to map out the key points of this high-dimensional landscape that I'm looking at. And the second step is to use those points as inputs to my enhanced sampling. And that gives me the free energy differences that I want. OK. So let me finish up now by talking about this business of very, very large time steps. OK, and I'm going to illustrate this with a very simple problem, just two harmonic oscillators, but two harmonic oscillators of very different frequency. So this is a fast frequency, and this is a slow frequency. OK, now if you take the algorithm that I gave you guys last time, all right, where I have first the slow evolution based on the slow force of the momenta, and then here for the fast force, since it's a simple harmonic oscillator, I'm actually going to use the analytical solution. All right? So I actually evolved this thing analytically according to the solution of a harmonic oscillator of frequency omega. And then finally, I correct once again with the slow force. OK. So that's a perfectly good multiple time scale algorithm, if you will. And I can, since everything is linear, I can represent this whole thing by a matrix A acting on my initial state to give me my final state. And the matrix looks like this, easy enough to work out. Okay? But if you actually go and you look at the eigenvalues of this matrix, something interesting happens. First of all, this is a unit determinant matrix, as we would expect it to be, because it's volume preserving. Depending on how you choose your time step here, your delta t, the eigenvalues will either be complex conjugate pairs, all right, which actually turns out will give you a trace of this matrix that lies between minus 2 and plus 2. But if you choose the time step too big, then you get the opposite thing happening. The two eigenvalues are real, and you find that the trace of the matrix is greater than or equal to 2. So there is a place where this transition occurs between complex conjugate pairs and real eigenvalues, and that actually occurs when the time step is n pi over omega. Big, OK, but that's the omega of the fast force. But this time step is supposed to be the one appropriate for the slow time scale. So let me actually just go back here and show you that this is supposed to be the time step associated with this slow force. But unfortunately, this transition between this behavior, which is stable, and this behavior, which would be unstable, real eigenvalues would give you hyperbolic solutions, is actually showing that there's a connection between the fast force and the slow time step. And this is called resonance phenomena. Right? I'm showing you here for a linear problem, but it also shows up in nonlinear problems as well. All right? And it tells me that there is a fundamental limit to this outer time step, this large time step that I can take. And that limit is governed by frequencies associated with the fast force, not the slow force. And that's why, in what I showed you in the last lecture, I can't push this big time step beyond a certain value, like 5 femtoseconds or 8 femtoseconds or whatever it was, even though I need to bridge much, much longer than that. Okay, so this has been a real thorn in our side for a long time, all right? Resonances have sort of plagued everything that we've tried to do because we get this fundamental limit. All right, so now we want to see how can I beat this resonance problem and really get very, very big time steps, okay? So there's a couple of approaches that have been suggested for doing this, all right? One is a recent paper by Bruce Byrne and Joe Marone called colored noise thermostating. I'm not going to talk about that. What I am going to talk about is something called isokinetic dynamics, and I'm going to combine it with something called Nose-Hoover chains, which I have a little bit of time to go over, with something I wanted to go over in the last lecture. All right, and we're going to actually do a stochastic version of that. So it's called the Nose-Hoover-Langevin thermostat, and that's the key to actually beating this problem. Okay, so let me actually flip back a little bit to something I didn't get to last time, but is actually kind of important for this. Okay, this is something that we developed also back in 92, and it's also now a very well-cited paper, called Nose-Hoover chains. All right, so let me just remind you, of course, standard classical MD is based on these Hamilton equations. R dot's P over M, P dot is equal to F. Okay. Around 1985, I think it was, Bill Hoover and Shuichi Nose developed a scheme that they call Nose-Hoover dynamics. All right? And it's kind of like Langevin dynamics in the sense that I have a damping force on my momentum. There's no stochastic force, though. Now, what they tried to do is they tried to get this damping thing based on the kinetic energy. So it's a dynamical variable. So it's written like a momentum, all right? But it plays the role of a friction term. But the way it works is we look at the kinetic energy that I have, and I look at the temperature that I want. So this is supposed to be basically 3 nkT in a canonical ensemble. And so we look at the fluctuations of that value around what it should be. And this is supposed to be a way of regulating the temperature in the system. So you notice that if this value, let's say, is too small, then what happens is that this term is going to be negative. And that's actually going to drive this variable to become negative itself. When this is negative, the sign changes, and this becomes a boost rather than a damping term. So it boosts the momentum and tries to make the kinetic energy higher. Now, when that happens, of course, this thing eventually becomes larger than 3 nkT. And so that will make this thing increase. All right, that's going to become larger. And it will go from negative to positive. When it becomes positive, this thing is negative. And so now it becomes a damping force. So by switching from damping to boosting to damping to boosting, we regulate the kinetic energy fluctuation so that on the average, you get the right temperature. OK. Well, that's a really cool idea. If you actually try to do it for, this is called Nose-Hoover dynamics, if you actually try to do it on a harmonic oscillator, you get the wrong answer. All right, so what you should get is a Boltzmann distribution for positions and a simple Boltzmann distribution, sorry, for momenta and for positions. So you should get simple Gaussians. And in fact, what you get is something that has these bumps in it and these spikes, and you get the wrong answer. And the reason is that if you look at the phase space plot, so you look at P versus X, you get a hole in the middle. So you get a kind of a donut. So that was a real problem. And so with my collaborator, Glenn Martina, and my postdoc advisor, Mike Klein, we looked at this problem and we said, well, maybe the problem is that this thing, this P eta, is also a momentum, and its temperature should be regulated too. So we said, OK, let's thermostat it. So we actually add a damping term for it, and we say that damping term should be determined by the fluctuations of the kinetic energy of that variable relative to kT, and you can keep going. All right, so you can actually get a chain of these things as long as you want. So we call this Nose-Hoover chains. And if you do it for the harmonic oscillator, so that was the original Nose-Hoover result. You do it for chains, and you actually get the right answer. So the phase place plot looks like this. It fills in the hole. And the distributions are exactly the analytical ones, as you would expect. OK, so that was kind of nice. But the mathematicians, who are also my colleagues in the Courant Institute, said, yeah, that looks great, but you can't prove that your equations are ergodic. You can't prove that you actually sample everything. All right? And on top of that, it didn't cure the resonance problem that I told you about. So we were faced with two issues. Math colleagues saying, you can't prove it's ergodic. And in the molecular dynamics community, we still had resonances. So now let me go back to where we left off. OK. So that led us into looking at something called isokinetic dynamics. All right? First of all, we were interested in seeing, could this actually cure resonances? All right, what does isokinetic dynamics do? As the name implies, isokinetic dynamics tries to fix or constrain the kinetic energy. So instead of having these funny fluctuations that you get from either Langevin dynamics or this Nose-Hoover approach, what we try to do is we say, let's constrain. Let's fix this kinetic energy term to be exactly equal to what we want. Now, why is it 3n minus 1 over 2 kT in this? The reason for that is that this is going to be a constraint. It's going to remove 1 degree of freedom from my system. So normally, this is supposed to be equal to 3 halves n based on the number of degrees of freedom which you have, which is 3n divided by 2 times kT. With a constraint, you lose 1. Okay. Oh, the way you introduce a constraint into any set of equations is with a Lagrange multiplier. All right, so my equations now look like this. I've got r dot is p over n. That's the Hamiltonian form that we had before. And now the p dot equation looks like p dot is f minus some multiplier times the momentum. And I'm going to use that Lagrange multiplier to enforce this constraint that I want above. All right, how do I do that? What I do is I take one time derivative of that constraint condition. Okay, so one time derivative will give me p over m times p dot. But p dot, and that's, of course, that time derivative has to be equal to 0, obviously. Right? Well, p dot, I substitute p dot its equation of motion, which is f minus lambda p. That gives me this term here. And then I simply solve for the multiplier. So given that that has to be equal to 0, I solve for the multiplier that I need. And that gives me f dot p over m divided by p dot p over m. Then if I put that multiplier back into the equations of motion, I have a set of equations that actually preserve or conserve the kinetic energy of the system. That's called isokinetic dynamics. And it really does conserve conserve this kinetic energy condition. So the distribution that you generate is not an exact canonical distribution. It's actually sort of mixed between a microcanonical and a canonical distribution. In the kinetic part, it's this. This is microcanonical. It says the kinetic energy is equal to a particular value. In the positions, however, fortunately, it is proper Boltzmann or canonical distribution. So that's usually the part that you care about. And you can show that that is exactly what you get. So isokinetic dynamics will, in fact, give you a proper canonical distribution. The reason that we think this might be resonance-free is that if I fix the kinetic energy, all right, then I never have this problem of going from bounded motion to unbounded motion. In unbounded motion, of course, the energy can grow unbounded. But if I'm constraining the kinetic energy, that can never happen. And yet it turns out that these equations actually fix the resonance problem. But as a thermostat, as a way of regulating the temperature, it's a very, very weak approach to it. So the sampling is extremely inefficient with this kind of scheme. All right? So it tends actually to be a very, very poor sampling approach. So on the one hand, we cure resonances by fixing the kinetic energy. On the other, we actually lose efficiency in sampling. All right, so that led us to try to figure out how we might beat that. But first, let's just talk about how we might integrate these equations, because we're going to need it anyway. OK, so the way we integrate the equations is, again, we divide up the Liouville operator into two parts. The first term is the standard kinetic energy part. The second one is given by all this Lagrange multiplier stuff that we got. So it's a kind of a complicated looking integrator. This k is, of course, equal to the value of my constraint. All right? OK. Turns out, so now I make the standard factorization. And it turns out that I can actually evaluate analytically this horrible looking operator. All right? It's not easy. You just work through the algebra, but you can actually get what this is on all my momenta. And so the algorithm that results is something that looks like this. All right? The momentum update set is the only thing that changes. And it changes by, instead of having the time step there, I have a function of the time step. That, those functions look like this. There's some Sinch and Cosh solutions, all right? And the parameters that go in there, the A and B, are given by these dot products that we saw in the multiplier, F dot P and F dot F. So my momentum update step looks like this now. It's P plus S of delta T over 2 times F divided by S dot. The position update is exactly the same. So then I have a force update, and then I have this momentum update step. Very simple algorithm, but it's perfectly isokinetic and perfectly resonance-free. OK, but it doesn't do the job for us. So what will do the job? What does the job is combining this scheme with that sort of Nose-Hoover-like approach that I showed you. So let's consider it for a simple case of one coordinate and one momentum, or Gamma velocity, so one velocity in this case. And so the equations that I'm going to look at are this. So here's my isokinetic scheme. I have my Lagrange multiplier in there for my coordinate, and that's my velocity. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to add in a kind of Nose-Hoover-like scheme like we had before. So here's the fluctuation of a velocity relative to kt. All right? And there's my dynamical damping force in the Nose-Hoover scheme. What I'm going to do is I'm going to have an isokinetic constraint between that velocity and that velocity. So that constraint looks like this. Right? And the reason I have this little j here is that I allow myself to have several of these kinds of couplings. We'll see that, in fact, the value of L is not very important here. And then this second velocity, the one that's sort of the Nose-Hoover-like thing, actually gets the damping and the stochastic part. So the Langevin equation is put into here. OK. I can derive the expression for the multiplier. It looks like this based on that constraint. Put it back in there, and I have a set of equations of motion that are isokinetic and kind of have this nice little Nose-Hoover coupling. OK. So I can come up with, we'll talk about integrators for these. But I just want to show you that, in fact, these equations do give me proper results for a real system. So here's an example of water. All right? So this is a flexible water model introduced by Francesco Paisani. And what I'm looking at here are the various radial distribution functions. All right? This is GOO. This is supposed to be GOH. And this is GAH. I'm apologize that they have the same label there. They're actually different radial distribution functions. What that is a measure of, if I'm sitting on a particular atom, what's the probability that there'll be another atom a distance r from where I'm sitting, all right? So for example, the fact that you see a strong peak here means a high probability of finding two oxygens about 2.8 angstroms away from each other. And that is the hydrogen bond length in water. So the black circles here are from a standard canonical simulation, MVT simulation. And then the different line colors are from this isokinetic scheme with the Langevin coupling with different friction values. And the results are fairly insensitive to the value of the friction for all three of these distributions. We can actually ask, well, how much does it depend on these Qs that I've introduced, this Q1 and this Q2? And in fact, it's also kind of insensitive. This is a measure of the error in these distribution functions for different values of these Qs. And mostly the values, the dark blue means that the error is small. And for most of these values, in fact, the error is really small, over basically two orders of magnitude for these Q values. They only kind of get to be large way out here, where one of the values is kind of taken to be extreme. So fortunately, there's not a lot of sensitivity to the parameters that you choose. OK. Now, how can we make this into a multiple time scale scheme? So we do the usual thing. We divide the forces up into intramolecular, short, and long range. So I'm going to have three time steps in my scheme. But because the Lagrange multiplier depends on the force as well, you see the force there in my expression for lambda, I actually have to break up the lambda into corresponding contributions. So I have an intramolecular, a short, and a long, and then a thermalization part. All right, just go back to the expression for lambda, and that's that part of it. Right? We call that the thermal part of lambda. So lambda now gets four contributions from my force decomposition. So these are the expressions. All right? And again, we're going to use our operator approach. So the way I decompose the operator now is, again, into kinetic, and then all the different terms for intermolecular, short, long, thermalization, and then the stochastic Ornstein-Uhlenbeck part of it. So those are all the definitions. Okay? No need to write all this down. You can go look up the paper. All this stuff is defined in there. So these are the operators that you have to deal with. You can solve each one of them analytically. And so at the end of the day, this is the decomposition I'm going to use. It's very much like what we looked at before. The only difference is here that I have thermalization and then long range, short range, and then here intramolecular. So this is very much like we looked at for Langevin dynamics. Intermolecular position, Ornstein-Uhlenbeck position, intermolecular. I do this m steps. I correct with short, and I run that n step. So I have, again, a small wheel, a big wheel, and then this outer thing, which should actually contain all of the expensive forces right there in this long range part. OK, so we're going to consider two types of multiple time scale decompositions in this that are kind of standard in molecular dynamics. One of them, so this is all based on Ewald summation. I don't know if anybody is familiar with Ewald summation, but Ewald summation is a way of handling Coulomb forces. And it divides the Coulomb force into a real space part and a reciprocal space part. The real space part is entirely short range, and the reciprocal space part is where all the long range stuff occurs. So in one scheme, I actually have a breakup of reciprocal space into two contributions that I call short and long, and real space into different contributions, plus my Leonard Jones. In the respite two, I actually throw the reciprocal space part out of the short range, and so short range is all based on real space stuff. Right? Okay. So first, let's look at a very simple, just a one-dimensional problem, all right? So this is just, it has a fast force and a slow force. And let's ask the question, well, how do I beat the resonance problem? So I set the big time step to the resonance time step, pi over omega, and then I look at a little time step, which is 100 times smaller than that. So that's already a factor of 100 difference between these steps. And you can see that with the new scheme, the analytical result and this isokinetic scheme, they match perfectly. If I go back to standard canonical dynamics in this red dashed line, the distribution is wrong, right? It's off. And in fact, if I look at, an error measure, which is the difference between the distribution I have at time t and the exact distribution, if I have my, so this one is from the isokinetic scheme, and this is from standard canonical dynamics. Well, because I'm at the resonance time step, the error actually grows, all right? So that's because, again, I have unbounded motion, and the error is going to grow in an unbounded way. On the other hand, my isokinetic scheme, I have a nice decrease of error of the number of steps, and I eventually converge to the correct distribution. Okay, so now we can look at errors as a function of my two parameters, Q1 and Q2, for different friction values. And you can see, again, it's not terribly sensitive to friction. And as long as the two Qs are kind of in a reasonable range, the error is small. It starts to grow if I make one of the Qs too large, as you can see out here, all right? But for example, in this plot, the error is really small over a wide range of Q values for a friction of like 0.1. So it gives some pretty good values for what we should choose. Notice here that the time steps are, again, 0.01 and 100 times bigger than that. So the suggestion here is that I can get really, really big outer time steps, at least for this simple example. Well, now let's look at the real problem. Okay? So this is the problem of water. Again, this flexible water model. And so here I'm using a little time step of 0.5 for the intramolecular stuff. I have an intermediate time step of about 3 femtoseconds for the short range stuff. And then I ask, what can I choose this outer time step to be? My short range cutoff here is about 6 angstroms, and the outer cutoff for long range interactions is about 12 angstroms. Okay? And so, again, the black symbols here are from a standard canonical dynamics run, and then I use big time steps of 9, 60, and even 100 femtoseconds, and there's no change in the distribution at all. Right? Same thing for OH and HH. All right? You would think that these two would be very sensitive because they have the fast bond vibration, the OH bond vibration in there, but it's not affected at all. So I can go to time steps as large as 100 femtoseconds in this case. You look at the error, and even for the largest time step, the error is the same as in the 9 femtosecond and the 60 femtosecond simulation. Same thing here for this distribution and for this distribution. So now, instead of being limited to an outer time step of 5 angstroms or 6 angstroms or whatever it is for water, I can actually now go to 100 femtoseconds, and I lose no accuracy at all. All right, so 3 time steps, 0.5, 3, and 100. All right, the savings in computational time now is at least an order of magnitude. So that's a bit, starts to be a big gain. Okay, I promised to show how much the L value affects things. So these are the distributions, again, OH in blue, OO in blue, OH in red, HH in green for different L values, and there's really no difference between them. So you can use L equals 1, or 2, or 4, and the answer doesn't really change any. Okay. Let's look at a protein. So this is the HIV protease in vacuum. Again, we ask the same question. If I have 0.5 femtoseconds for my intramolecular forces, 3 femtoseconds for the long, for the short range forces, what can I choose the outer time step to be? Now here I call the delta T3. And so what we're looking at here is the carbon oxygen. So the carbon-carbon distribution in this thing. All right? So that's a kind of bumpy distribution with a lot of stuff in it, but you can see that my benchmark of 1 femtosecond and then I can push the time step all the way, outer time step in my multiple time stepping scheme, again, all the way out to about 100 femtoseconds, and there's no change in that distribution. Okay? Here I'm focusing in on an intramolecular peak, so this comes from this carbon hydrogen distribution, and again, there's no change in that. It's the question.
Have you tried even larger time steps?
Yes, we have. And at some point, it does start to break down. I'll show you an example of that for 300 femtoseconds. The deviations, so I'll come back to that, but you start to see little deviations if you go too much higher than 100. I think we can maybe push it out to 150, but you start actually not to gain anything if you go too high in the outer time step, because there is an overhead associated with the short-range force evaluation. So there is a kind of plateau in terms of what you can gain. Okay. But getting out to 100 or more femtoseconds is a significant breakthrough in terms of our ability to do very large time step molecular dynamics for fully atomistic models, which is what I'm doing here. And you could do the same thing for any coarse-grained model that you like, whatever it is. Same idea. Okay, now our newest work is in treating polarizable models. Right, this is a kind of new direction in force field development. I mean, polarizable models have been around for a while, but now we want to develop real force fields, real protein force fields that can handle polarization. Okay, how do polarizable models work? Same kind of thing. You have all the same terms: bond, angle, torsion, van der Waals, electrostatics. However, you have a new contribution, which is electrostatics due to induced dipoles, all right, which is coming from the polarization. This is one way to do polarization. So your dipoles are basically given by a permanent dipole moment, which is, of course, given by whatever your charges are, and then an induced term, which comes from the local electric field. All right? So this T matrix is determined by that. And what you have to do to get all the induced dipoles is to solve this set of equations. It looks like a set of linear equations, and in fact, you can solve them that way. But this matrix is enormous, all right? So you actually don't want to do an explicit matrix inversion. So the usual thing is to do a kind of self-consistent iterative scheme to solve these equations. And that creates a big overhead, too. All right? Not as bad as if you tried to invert the matrix, but it's still expensive to do these calculations. So here's an area where multiple time stepping can actually come into play. All right. The way we do that is we have a set of short-range dipoles that come from a matrix that we compute by only looking at neighbors within a certain cutoff. And that actually makes this matrix that goes in here very, very sparse, and allows us to use sparse matrix algebra and actually to solve this. So this equation, if this cutoff is small, can actually be very, very, very efficient. Then, of course, we get polarization forces from this. And if we want the long-range part, we do the full calculation. And so our long-range part can be taken as the difference between the total force and the short-range force. So here are our first results. All right, this is brand new, unpublished work for a polarizable water model. And this gets back to the question of, well, what happens if you try to push the time step out to 300 femtoseconds or so? So these are the OO, OH, and HH distribution functions. And you can see that as long as your time step is kind of within 100 femtoseconds, there's no change in those. At 300 femtoseconds, the black line, we start to see some deviations. That's because I'm not integrating that long-range force accurately enough. They're not huge, but they are there. But the simulation is at least still stable. So I could use very, very large time steps for equilibration purposes if I wanted. But then eventually, when I want to calculate things, I should actually kind of back off and go to something like 100 or 150 femtoseconds. OK. So We'll have plenty of time for questions, but let me just summarize what we've done so far. So as an application, I showed you an enhanced sampling scheme that was based on temperature acceleration. And it had a stiff harmonic force in it. So I created a multiple time scale problem, but I have the algorithms available to solve it. So I have a really robust enhanced sampling scheme that I can use to calculate free energies. Okay, but we saw that resonances are a problem and they place limits on what the outer time step can be in your standard multiple time stepping approaches. So if I introduce this idea of kinetic energy constraints, then I prevent any mode from becoming resonant. And when I combine this with this isokinetic Nose-Hoover approach, then I can get very, very large outer time steps. The main thing to note here, and I kind of didn't say it because we only looked at equilibrium properties, is that when you do this scheme, you actually don't get the correct dynamics. All right? So it's really there to be a sampling approach. Now, I hinted at a scheme when my first slide here where I said there is a way to do this with what are called colored noise or generalized Langevin dynamics. So this is the generalized Langevin equation. All right? And the way colored noise thermostatting works is to tune this memory kernel that goes in here. This is the generalization of your dissipative term in such a way that you try to reproduce as closely as possible the true dynamics of your system. All right? And so that's a scheme that's kind of out there in the literature. But the problem with it is that it still doesn't preserve the exact dynamics. So you can do the best you can by optimizing this kernel. But at the end of the day, if I look at, let's say, the infrared spectrum of water, all right, this is what it should be, this dark line here. And then these are what I get from this colored noise approach. Okay, it's not bad. You can see the peaks kind of are in the right place, but they're certainly not the right height, and they do get a little bit shifted. So as long as you care only about sort of kind of slow dynamics, if you're interested in diffusive processes and things like that, then maybe this colored noise approach could work. But if you're interested in any other part of the spectrum here, it's going to break down, which is why I didn't go into this scheme. It's an interesting one, but in my view, getting true dynamics while still beating this resonance problem in multiple time stepping, that's an open question. I think it's always good to stop with an open challenge that has yet to be solved. So this is where I'll stop. And just that there's plenty of time for questions, so you know, please feel free to ask anything that you're curious about. Thanks.
Right?
Yeah, so it's a huge difference. So how much
I don't. Unless I've tested it. I tend not to believe it. When we did our melting of copper study, we actually carefully tested the melting temperature. And it's with that model that we were using, this embedded atom model, we were really strikingly close to the experimentally known melting temperature. I think the experimental temperature was around, for copper, around 1360 something, and we were also like maybe around 1358. And we were really, really close. So in that case, I believe it. For water, yeah. Different story. I mean, apart from coarse graining, I don't think that you can, I mean, with just time stepping alone, I don't think you can bridge that far. Right? I mean, I can get you a factor of 100 or 200 in the time step, but I'm not getting you 10 orders of magnitude in the time step, because there is still a need to integrate. If you're going to use an atomistic model, there is still a need to integrate, you know, this long-range motion. You just can't get rid of it. So if you want to get to that kind of bridging, then I think the only way to do it right now is through some level of coarse graining. How much can I coarse grain what?
Give you in terms of speed up?
Well, I think it depends on how coarse you make your model, right? I mean, if I'm going to replace, let's say, a small chemical group by a single bead, I'm still kind of fine grained, right? So I can usually get to I can probably easily get to the millisecond regime in that. Maybe even starting to approach seconds. Right? But if I really want to go way beyond that, let's say I'm interested in the dynamics of viruses or things like this, then, you know, what I need to do is I sort of need to take entire domains of proteins and replace them by a single interaction site. And that's very, very aggressive coarse graining. People are doing that. And that can sort of, you know, start to get you there. But you lose a lot of resolution when you do it. So you have to look at what it is you want to compute, what it is you want to study, and decide how much coarse graining you can live with based on that. You know, but then that will determine the time scale that you can look at. Obviously, the more you coarse grain, the further out in time you can go.
And yeah, when you decomposed these ubiquitous operators, you did that usually by some kind of intuition, I guess, or looking at the formula, for example, one at the blackboard, and then. Yeah, there was some
okay,
kind of
yeah.
natural way to split it up.
Yes.
But is there a possibility maybe to find an kind of optimal split up, for example, by introducing new coordinates or something like that, to give the best separation of time scales?
Maybe. If, for example, I wanted to use like normal modes, try to do a mode decomposition, I might be able to get a better splitting based on fast modes versus slow modes, and maybe even have different hierarchies, slow, very slow, intermediate, and fast, or I could have as many of these as I felt I could stand, right? That could work, and that is a coordinate transformation, right? That would kind of do it for you. I think people have tried that, and it sort of works. The same issues come up there. Resonances are still present in those kinds of schemes. Plus, you have the added bit of you need to refresh the modes every now and then, right? Because they're just local modes. So if you get a big conformational change, then you need new normal modes, right? You can't just keep using the same ones. So you keep refreshing it. There's an overhead to pay for that. I don't know. I mean, you can maybe use internal coordinates of some kind, but I don't think there's been too much success with that, as opposed to just using intramolecular forces.
Normally, it's impossible to make a type of zigzag of the coarse grain for some materials such as solid crystal material. So if I want to just make their time space larger, like you, 10 of picoseconds. So is there any way to just realize it? If I just want to real to do with their some materials, but with some atoms, not to the coarse grain, not to the coarse grain model, it's just their optimistic model.
Fully atomistic.
Yeah, yeah.
Then the schemes that I talked about today should be, you know, useful in that case, but you're not going to you know, you're going to have all the same issues that I talked about. So resonances will be there. You need a resonance-free approach. But that's sort of what these schemes are designed to handle, are fully atomistic models. But there will be a limit to the time step that you can use in that case, because it is an atomistic model. But I can get you to about 100 femtoseconds, if that will help.
But sometimes if I just enlarge the time state, I think the model will be unstable.
If you just, that's true. If you just do a single time step scheme and you push the time step to 100 femtoseconds, it will probably break. I would agree with that, right? That's why you need several time steps. You need several levels and you need several time. What kind of model are you talking about? So using, are you using any kind of like embedded atom approach, or is it just standard pairwise interactions? If it's just standard pairwise, then the schemes I talked about should kind of be perfect for that. If you're using embedded atom models, you know, you can still do it. It's a little more complicated, but you can still do it. Okay, it looks like there's nothing else, so I think we'll stop here. Thanks.